of mine at Bamberg University. Then he spent a couple of months in Sweden. What happened in Sweden? Almost in Sweden, right? No. Then he received a bachelor in March 2009. And then he immediately continued with master courses in business informatics in Bamberg. And he wrote a master thesis on pattern-based analysis of WS Beetle and Windows workflow. Then he was a guest lecturer again in Sweden for a few months, and then continued his PhD studies with Guido Wirz, his first supervisor, and got a PhD with honors, summa cum laude, with honors, and the subject is exactly this subject, and Jörg, I'm looking forward to it. Oh, Enami, sorry, Enami is in Sweden again, as a postdoc. I can't understand it. Okay, thank you.
Yeah. So give me a second. Okay, yeah, so thank you very much, Mark, for the nice introduction for the place. Also, so I'm obviously very happy to be here today on this occasion and to be distinguished as the first recipient of the Christos Nicolaou PhD Award.
Oh, I have a duty. You must speak Greek.
Greek.
Otherwise, you have to pay
tax. I think I know Ophian and I. Those are the words. Anyway, I have to admit that I haven't met Christos, unfortunately, so we never attended a joint conference, it seems. But I promise to do my best to keep his name in honor and to live up to the expectations set up by this award by while doing high quality research. And I also have to say that I'm very happy to be here today on Crete and in this very place. So not only because I have an award, but also because of the place that I'm at, because this place has a kind of personal meaning for me as well. I've been here before at this hotel at the first conference that I attended as a PhD student about half a year into the PhD. That was CoOpus 2011. And well, back then my situation was very, very different because I hadn't yet found a good PhD topic, I hadn't yet identified a good research question. So basically I was a little bit desperate at the time. At the conference I was then trying to speak to as many professors as possible and nagging them with all kinds of stupid, unworkable ideas to see if that might turn into a PhD topic. And, well, it didn't work out. I didn't find my topic quite at the conference. That took some more reading, some more working as well, but it's very nice to be back here 5 years later and to look back at that situation in a totally different setting with having done the work, having found the topic, and even being considered worthy of such an award. That's really a great feeling, so thank you very much. Now, what I want to talk about is, of course, my thesis. So in the next 40-45 minutes, I want to give you more of an overview of what I did. So I want to show you what the general ideas were, what the general questions were I tried to tackle, and what some of the most general results were. So I won't dive too, or I won't look too much at the specifics, but rather give an overview talk. And I'll also look a little bit deeper into selected parts to show you what methods I applied, how I came to the conclusions that I arrived at. But before I talk on that, let's talk a little bit about people. So as has been said, all this work has been done as a member of the Distributed Systems Group of the University of Bamberg under the supervision of Guido Wirz, who is also here, which I'm very happy about also, and in heavy collaboration with my fellow PhD colleagues, which you also can see here. So we did a lot of joint projects together, and some of these also made it into my PhD piece. So the work wouldn't be the same without these people, which is, I want to mention Simon Hager, Matthias Geiger, and Stefan Kohl. And just as a side note, Stefan Kohl is also the author of Persify It, which we've heard a lot about in the last talk of the last session before that. So hopefully they are then complete as well soon. And now you might notice, well, this logo is different from that logo, and as also been said, I've moved to another institution again in Sweden. very nice. It's very light, very much daylight. I haven't had a night for the last 2 weeks, basically. So I had to fly to Crete to see night again. But there, I started at the University of Karlstad, which is a very young university that is now heavily expanding. And I moved into the software engineering research group there. So you might think that coming from distributed systems to software engineering, I now completely changed topics and I'm doing different things now, but that's not quite the case, because previously I was applying software engineering methods to distributed software, more or less. And I was caring about software portability, that's in the title of my thesis. And the research direction of this group is basically quality of evolving long-living software systems. So portability of software fits very nicely into that area, and I continue my work there as the services specialist. Okay, so much for affiliation. Now I'll come to the actual content, and I think the mic is not quite working. It's okay. So I'm just hearing the difference. Okay, so I won't spend too much on basics for the services conference, of course, but let me just say a few words. Today, we engineer distributed application systems as service-oriented systems. That means that we encapsulate the basic unit of functionality, basic self-contained functionality as self-contained units of application services, microservices, whatever you may call that. And there are a few often mentioned benefits of that. I mean, we have uniform interfaces. So we abstract from the implementation details, we describe these in a technologically neutral fashion, and we let services interact using public wire message exchange, and that has a lot of benefits. It means that you can kind of plug larger systems together out of smaller service systems in a Lego fashion, more or less, by exchanging messages between these singular components. And the real advantage comes when we combine that, when we kind of build the glue between these services. So the way we typically do that is in a process-aware fashion. We describe the data flow and the control flow between the invocation of services, between their message exchanges, via particular process-aware code, via process languages, basically. And this is the general setting that my thesis is positioned in. So, of course, we're not doing that with Lego pieces, but we have a lot of standards in this area, a lot of languages in this area that allow you to build programs that do this kind of service composition, this kind of service orchestration. So for instance, what you see here, what you probably all know, is a BPMN visualization of a process model, of a service interaction pattern, actually. And behind this process model, it really is an implementation in ePub. So see, we have a lot of standards in this area. And where things get interesting for me is the actual execution part of such applications, the enactment part of process models. So what we have here, typically, is we have an implementation of a service composition, a service orchestration in a process model, and at implementation time, you deploy that to a particular type of middleware, which we call engine, process engine, workflow engine, or whatever. And this engine then takes care of execution. Now, so far so good, nothing I've said is in any way new. So you might wonder where in my thesis title that strange term process-aware and service-oriented software comes from. Because what I describe here is the setting of a service orchestration, a service composition, which are terms that are much more often used in this area. So why did I choose that particular term that is also just used in my thesis title? Well, I wanted to send two important signals for my work with using explicitly that term and with explicitly employing the term software. On one hand, when you talk about service orchestrations or service compositions, it's not quite clear what you actually mean. There are many people working in this area, and many view it also as a modeling aspect or as an analysis aspect. They don't care of actually executable orchestration models, but abstract models that you can do then analysis on, deadlock checking, and other verifications, for instance. But what I care about is really executable software. So I care about if in the reply activity of a people process model you use a message exchange and throw a fault, because that has implications for my work. And normally, if you're more modeling and analysis, then you abstract from these terms. So I wanted to introduce the term software into my thesis title to really signal that. Another reason is that I want to connect to a certain stream of literature in my work, namely from software engineering, which has a lot of work on software measurement or on software metrics, and how you define software metrics, how you evaluate them. And I wanted to connect software and metrics as well in my thesis title. So that's where process aware and service aware software comes from, but you could also call that orchestration if you want, in a sense. Now, the place where it really becomes interesting for my work is the interface between the engine and the process model, because this interface is defined by standards today. We have standards like BPMN or Beeple in which we implement a process model. And then the process model should conform to the standard. And then we have implementations of these standards. So engines that implement BPMN or Beeple. And the great benefit that we get from it is that we can take our process model, implement it in the standard, and deploy it on any implementation of the standard. And if we have a variety of those available, we can freely switch between these implementations. So in other words, we have portability. And that brings a lot of benefits. Well, the most well-mentioned benefit in that area is protection from vendor lock-in. So we can kind of ditch the expensive WebLogic server that we have to pay huge money on license fees and just use an open source version that supports the same standard, so we save a lot of money. Another benefit might be that we can easily switch to a newer version of the same engine. So say a new engine becomes available that offers much better performance characteristics, we can just take our software and move it to the new engine without really any effort on our side. Or we can move it to a completely different new engine. So say a new cloud-based process engine, of which more and more being offered now. We can easily take our software if it conforms to the standard and deploy it to that standards-conforming cloud engine. So a lot of benefits that we have for portability. And this is also the reason why we build standards in the end, because we want to have similar formats, similar serializations here. So also the standards that are important say that portability is very, very important here. For instance, BPMN 2.0 says that one of its main goals is to enable portability of process diagrams. And in BPMN 2.0, that does not only apply to graphical stuff, but also to the executable part of the language. They also want to have executable process models that you can freely port among BPMN engines. Beeple, in a sense, is the poster boy for that. So that specification has really been developed to allow porting of executable process models. So it says that the language actually effectively defines a portable execution form for business processes. Those are not the only standards. We also have, for instance, the XML process definition language that also has the goal to promote portability of abstract activity flow models between tools. Here the focus might be a little bit more on visualization, but I've been told by one of the heads of the Workflow Management Coalition that XPDL engines do exist, are used in practice, and portability matters for them as well. So it's also important here. And then we have cloud standards. We have heard a lot about COSCA today, and we'll hear some more, I guess, in the next days. But also Tosca reuses these languages precisely because they should enable portability of plans. So Tosca states that the specification relies on existing languages like BPMN or Beeple, and relying on existing standards in the space facilitates portability. So in a sense, Tosca inherits the portability of its plans from the above standards. Now, what if BPMN or Beeple process models were not actually portable among engines? That has implications, of course, that has problems, leads to problems for Tosca as well. So, in theory, everything is fine, of course. We have the standard, so all we need to do is implement our models in the standard, and then we can use any implementation of the standard. That's the notion that exists. I mean, we have no certification authorities for BPMN or Beeple. Any vendor can claim that. So it's very easy to assume that you get portability by just relying on the standard. But in practice, it will typically look a little bit different. So in practice, we typically have a language standard that's kind of a programming language in the end that defines a set of features, a set of language constructs that you can use to build programs. So a set of features you can use to build process such a standard are typically not perfect. So they typically don't cover all of the actual features defined by the standard. They might even provide more, but typically they don't provide they don't overlap exactly with the standard. They might have bugs, they might consider a certain part of the standard not important. We have nobody that enforces that an engine can only call itself an engine when it really implements the standard. But the problem is that we will only be able to port code that is limited to the small subset that is really in the intersection of what all of the implementations support. And that might be much, much smaller than what the standard actually defines. But we don't really know about how this might look in practice, what part of the language that might be, and how large it is. And this is the setting that I addressed in my paper. So my thesis separates in two main parts. First part is the kind of evidence part. So I tried to find out what the current situation is, considering the most important standards we have and the most important engines we have. What part of the standards is actually supported by these engines? Based on these standards, can we guarantee portability of our process models? That's what I tried to find out, and while providing really hard and reproducible evidence for that was a lot of problem work. But unsurprisingly, I found that it's a difficult situation, so the standard support is quite limited in the engines. The intersection is very limited with today's standards. And as a result, we don't get portability for free by just applying standards. So portability is still something that we want to leverage. I mean, it brings a lot of benefits. So in the face of incomplete standards, how can we still try to improve the portability of our applications? That is kind of the second part of my thesis work. And what I did here was to apply very classical software engineering methods for software quality improvement. Because in the end, software portability is just a software quality aspect. And the methods I applied were measurement methods. Because here the idea is, if you want to improve the quality of a piece of software, then you need to be able to grasp what degree of quality the software actually implements. So you need to be able, is this bad or is it good, in a sense. And if you can, compute that automatically, and if you can observe it constantly during development, so in a kind of continuous integration pipeline, if you can observe for every commit to your source, does quality go down or does it go up, and then you can really take countermeasures to improve it. And that's what I tried to tackle in the second part. So I basically tried to develop software measurement methods and evaluate these methods for process models, basically, and for their portability. So that leads to a number of sub-questions, a number of sub-goals in my thesis, and two of which I want to now consider a little bit closer. But firstly, concerning the measurement part, I have a certain quality model underlying my work that is kind of the most important quality standard we have today, an ISO standard. And this standard defines portability as a major aspect of software quality, but not as a normally standing aspect. So it's really portability according to the standard is related to a number of other characteristics, namely installability, adaptability, and replaceability. So in my thesis, I try to tackle each of these aspects with a separate study, with a separate thesis chapter basically, and try to derive and find metrics that help you to measure that for process models. So in the following, I want to look a little bit deeper into the evidence part and a little bit deeper into the measurement part. So when it comes to the evidence part, I wanted to find out if current standards are sufficient to enable the to guarantee the portability of process models. Excuse me. Okay, standards are sufficient to guarantee portability if there's a number of implementations available that supports the standard fully as claimed, that fully conform to the standard. Because then we can freely choose between these engines. This is the ideal picture. And therefore, what I needed to analyze is how well engines actually support the standard. If it looks more like this picture, then of course, we don't get portability for free, then we have an issue here. So what I did was to take the most important standards in this area and build a mechanism to be able to analyze implementations of these standards regarding to how well they support the standards. So I did conformance benchmarking of a number of process engines. I basically looked at the standards and defined test cases for every feature that the standard defines. These are little test programs that focus on one particular activity, for instance, let's say an invoke activity in vehicle, a script task in VPNN, and capture that feature in an executable process model that is as minimal as possible. It really focuses just on the feature. So then I had a number of tests and I could execute these tests on a number of engines. And if the engine passed the test, I could say the engine really supports the feature. And now if a multitude of engines supports the feature, I can say it is kind of correlated. So in the end, I wanted to basically paint that Venn diagram with real standards and with real engines. So what did I look at? Well, I started working with Beagle and continued working on Beagle testing for all of my PhD. So there's a little bit more results here, but I also looked at VPNN. So I would say that I covered the most important standards that we have in this area. And for these languages, I built two sets of conformance tests, two conformance test suites, which are these kind of minimal test programs that focus on one particular feature of the language in isolation. So two conformance test suites. And for Beagle, I also build a test suite of workflow control flow patterns, the classical patterns by Fanger Alles, basically, that then allow you to see if an engine actually supports one of the variants that make up this pattern. Then I took a number of engines and had a look how well these engines actually support these standards, how well they pass the tests. Again, for Beagle, I have a little bit more results because I worked longer on that, so I have the five most important open source engines here and three commercial engines that I benchmark under an academic license, so I cannot now publicly say their name, but let me assure you that you all know the vendors of these engines. They also were, they also built the Beagle specification itself, so they're quite big. And for BPMN, I also looked at the three most important engines that we have today. And what I then did, well, was to take all these tests and run them on all these engines and then look at the results. Now that is a very complex process, executing all these tests on all these engines, that is easy to make mistakes and it's also hard to reproduce, so I didn't do that manually, but together with my PhD colleagues, I implemented a benchmarking tool called Betsy that really fully automates the benchmarking process for process engines. You just have to tell it what engines you want to evaluate and what tests you want to take, and then it fully automatically executes these tests for the engine. And the results are always the same. So you can use this tool to reproduce what I demonstrated in my thesis. It's also open source and freely available, so really anybody can use the tool and reproduce the data that I have shown, maybe with the exception of the commercial engines, because of course I cannot give those away. But for the open source ones, it's no problem. And well, the big benefit is it's a good useful, so my evidence can really be also looked at by other people. And some of the engine vendors have done that and also have helped us in improving the tests and making sure that they are really correct. Now, this benchmarking procedure takes fully sequentially a test and executes it on an engine, so that takes very long. In particular, because the testing process, well, it doesn't look complex, but it's very time-consuming. So, for instance, for every test case, I need to completely reinstall the engine under test for reasons of test isolation, because we found that for certain tests that an engine may fail, it may completely wreck the engine instance. So, for instance, one engine, if there was an infinite loop in the process model, the engine just crashed. All parallel and future process instance executions as well. So we really had to reinstall the engine under test. And if you do that a few hundred times, then the whole procedure takes a few days, basically. But in the end, we have the same results. So you can do that quite nicely. And what I want to provide with now, a very general overview of the results, because it can go into all the details. So what you see here is the state of implementation of people for these engines. On the x-axis, you see the engines, so the 5 open source engines and 3 commercial engines. And for every engine, there's 3 pillars. Every pillar stands for a different group of language constructs of people. So for instance, basic activities, scope and structured activities. And on the y-axis, you see the percentage of successful tests, so kind of the degree to which the engines implement the standard. In green, of course, successful, in red, failed. And just a very general observation that we can see from this picture, no engine actually passes all the tests. So no engine of these fully supports the people specification. And interestingly, this one is a form of the reference implementation of people. But still, it fails some tests, some very special tests, I have to admit. For instance, it doesn't throw certain faults when it should throw them. In people, when there's concurrent receives that wait on the same correlation set, the same operation, the engine should throw a concurrent receive fault, but for instance, even the not even the reference implementation does that. So, firstly, we can say no engine really implements the complete standard, so that question is kind of if people's standardization has really been successful. And another aspect we see is that we have an interesting curve, so a varying degree of support in the specification of the different engines. So we can expect that portability will be difficult because these engines will support different constructs, different degree as well. So we can't just assume that we use people and get portability. And we have the same picture for EPMM. So here we have fewer engines, of course, a few more pillars because of more language constructs. But the picture we have is the same. No engine actually implements the complete standard. And the things that they implement really do vary. There's a varying degree of support. So we can't rely on EPMM as well if we care about portability. And if you look at the intersection of the tests, so the tests that are passed by all engine under test, kind of the common feature set that you get for these standards. And for people, for instance, 16% of our tests are passed by all engines under test. So that is that part of the language that's really portable to every engine. That's the most basic stuff. Basic receives, basic replies, basic invokes, basic sequence structure. And if you kick out the worst engine, which was really bad, which you might not want to consider mature, and take the shared tests by 7 or 8 out of 8 engines, then you arrive at around 40% of the language that really works on every engine. But still, that excludes the most interesting stuff, termination handling, compensation handling, and so on. Support is very, very different here. And if you look at BPMN, you get kind of the same result. So also, 40% of the things that we tested for are actually supported by all engines. That's the stuff that you can rely on if you care about portability. So for BPMN, just an outline, what we have. That works in every engine is again the most basic stuff. So unconditional sequence flows, trivial event types, trivial tasks, although you have to take care of the scripting language you use, basic hierarchical decomposition, some event types, also parallel control flow definition. Then there's a mix of things that have a kind of varying degree of support, and in the end a few features of the standard that are not supported at all. Interestingly, that's parallelism. So with BPMN, you can always define a parallel, a forking of the control flow, but what we found that was no engine ever actually executed anything in parallel. They always only executed an interleaving of the control flow definition, and that interleaving was in no way random. It was always determined by the way in which the activities are listed in the XML file, either bottom up or top down, so no real parallelism. Also, the standard looping mechanism doesn't work at all. You can still build loops in BPMN with cycles in the control flow graph or with the multi-instance facility, but not with the standard facility, interestingly. So quite a lot of the standard then is not really relevant to the engine when it succeeds. And what I can conclude from that is that standardization has not been successful for the two standards. So the goal of standardization is to have multitude of implementations of the standard that fully conform to the standard, that support the standard as it is defined. And we don't have that here. I can definitely say that, because for all standards I could show that not all of the standards have been implemented and the degree varies a lot. So that means portability might be actually very difficult, because we just have that small subset of the language that you can rely on. And that leads kind of to the second part. So how can we improve the portability of our process models, although the standards are not that well supported? And my idea was to apply absolutely classical methods of software engineering, software measurement, to observe portability during development and to take care that you achieve it to the degree you find necessary. So I built measurement tools that quantify the portability of process models, and I also point you to specific parts of the process model and say, here's a portability issue, that special syntax won't work very well. So that can really help developers to build more portable code. That was my goal. So first, let me now talk about the standard that kind of gave the setting for my PhD thesis in this area. That's the ISO standard, the software quality requirements and evaluation method or model. That's the most well-known quality model we have in software engineering. And it's currently being reworked by the ISO. So at the time that I did my PhD thesis, this general model that you see here was available already, but no standard that defined how you can actually measure an aspect of quality here. And that standard has been concluded in the meantime, so in March or April, I think, but it's not yet public. So I still remain to see how close I was with my assumptions, basically. And, well, this quality model defines what quality is in the area of software. So there are 8 major software quality aspects that you consider when you talk about software quality. And most of those are well known, are considered in many studies. So maintainability, security, performance, usability, all these are aspects that we very often consider. But the model also defines portability as a major aspect of software quality. And portability is something that is not so often considered in software engineering work. And as I said before, portability is also not a standalone characteristic of software quality, but related to a few others. Adaptability, installability, and replaceability. So in my work, I tried to really look at all of these aspects and try to find metrics that allow me to measure this for the software tools and for process tools, basically. So I targeted each of these aspects with a separate study. And how did it work? Well, of course, I started with the literature review first, so I tried to look how do other people measure this particular aspect of software quality. Do metrics already exist here? Can I somehow apply them to the software I'm looking at? Can I maybe somehow improve them, improve the state of the art with measurement in that area? So I derived new metrics. Then I performed a validation of that, because in the software metrics stream of literature, there's a number of frameworks that describe how you build and define and evaluate software metrics. And they specify certain properties that you should fulfill, such as, for instance, a software engineering metric should never yield a negative value, for instance, and a few other properties. So I had to take care that the metrics I was looking at also provided these aspects. And then I did a practical evaluation of the metrics. So I tried to test them on real software and see how well they perform. That means I firstly implemented everything I had specified before in the measurement tool. So a kind of prototype that you can point to the manual of Google process models, and then you apply some volumetric value that you can look at. Then I set a number of hypotheses I wanted to evaluate regarding the quality of the metrics to see how well the metrics perform and if they actually work. And then I collected a number of real applications that I could actually evaluate and could actually get metric values from, resulting basically in a list of metric values that I could then do statistical analysis on. And then I could say, well, this metric does not work, or maybe this one is better, for instance. And we could narrow the scope of useful aspects a little bit. So let me just in the remaining time talk a little bit about the major aspect about portability. So how do you measure portability and how can you make that measurable for process models? So portability is mentioned in almost every software quality model we have, but hardly
we have for computing probability looks like this. So you compare two aspects. On one hand, you compare the effort it takes to port the software. So the effort it takes to take the cross-run from one engine to another, the effort we have to invest in that. And compare that to the effort of starting again from the green field. So throwing everything away that you've written before and just rewriting that completely for the new platform. And the general assumption here is that the effort of porting will never be higher than the effort of actually not porting or starting again from the green field. And if that works out, and you divide one by another and subtract it from one, you get a nice value that ranges between 0, standing for no portability, not portable at all, to 1, full portability. You can directly take that piece of software and move it somewhere else. And that's something that you can interpret very nicely, that you can mentally work with. And the difficult part, of course, is how to actually come up with the effort. That's the hard part here. And of course, on the one hand, you can do expert estimates. So you can have people who really know the area and the software, have a look at the software, and then say, this will take so and so many hours, for instance. That may be very accurate, but it's not easy to repeat. At least it's very costly to repeat. So you can't really do that during software development, because the experts are expensive, and you can't have a look at the software at multiple times so easily. So what I wanted to arrive at was an automatic way of computing these values. The way in which this can automatically be done is by relying on lines of code. That's the way also other people have done it. So what you do is you look at the piece of software and look at every line of code. And if you find that this line must be modified for porting, you count it. So kind of you count the lines that have portability issues in them. That's the effort of porting. And you compare that to the total lines of code of the complete program, because in the end, if you throw it away and rewrite it, then strictly speaking, you have to rewrite every line of code. And that fits exactly in this scheme. This allows us to automatically compute portability. And this is what I built upon. So for this, I kind of ported to cross-modeling, to the cross-modeling languages we have here, and made it practically work there, and also define a few extensions that allow me to look at certain aspects of the cross modeling. So I basically defined four metrics that I wanted to evaluate. The first is a baseline metric that is classical in the sense that it exactly implements the scheme of computation as I just explained. So I look at every element of a process model and see if there's a portability issue in it. And then I count that element and compare it to the total amount of evidence. The difficulty here is, of course, for a given that I need to determine for a given element in the code if there's a portability issue in it. And I can do that based on the conformance data that I've gathered before. Because before, I've tested every feature of the standard and had a look at if it really works on all engines, or at least on the majority of engines. So I can use this data in static analysis and have a look at every line of code and see if some strange feature combination is used here that might result in a portability issue. And then I can count. So I can fully automatically compute this metric, which alone is kind of an addition to the state of the art. But I thought I could do better. Because on the one hand, you might consider portability not as a binary thing, so not just portable or not portable. Because maybe we have this language element that works on 7 out of 8 engines. That's pretty portable. I mean, you can just not take that to one particular engine. And on the other hand, you might have certain language features that work on 2 out of 8 engines, and that is not very portable, because you just have those two available. So what I did was to introduce exactly this weighting into the computation, to not consider portability as a binary aspect of portable or non-portable, but as a sort of weight question, and capture that in a specific metric that I wanted to evaluate. Then I thought not every feature of a process model is equally important. For instance, we have the activities that make up the control flow graph. These are obviously very important. And on the other hand, we, for instance, have many different ways to initialize a variable in people. That's not so important. So if there's a portability issue in variable initialization, that's kind of less important than if there's an issue in the control flow graph. Because if we have to change the control for graph reporting, we might end up with a functional change in the process model. And that is, well, getting a functional change from a non-functional change requirement for a build view, that's not considered good. And so I build a metric that just focuses on the control for graph in the process model. And in addition to that, I also will have a look at the communication flow kind of, because we have specific elements in process model that are relevant for communication with send and receive messages. And if we have portability issues in these elements, then and have to modify these elements for porting, then we might end up triggering a functional change in the third-party system that communicates with the process model. And that is really something that is not desirable at all. So I also will define a metric that concentrates only on the element on the elements that are relevant for message sending and reception, kind of communication flow. And then I tried to evaluate these metrics based on the real world software. And for this, of course, I need a real world software. And I mean, it's nice if you have industry contacts that are willing to give you their actual process models, but unfortunately, I had to do without that. So I needed to come up with a few other sources from where I could get real applications. And I started out by taking freely available applications from a few people, engine vendors that offer connections of process models to show off what their engine can do or to provide a test set for the engine. So I arrived with these numbers. Then I had a look at different kinds of sources where process models are made freely available. So that's things like Stack Overflow or the Beacon mailing list. So I watched this for some time and took all the models that I could find. But I wasn't quite satisfied with the numbers. So what I did in the end was to do an online repository crawling of open source software repositories. So we have a few major repositories today that host kind of all of the open source software that we have. That's SourceForge, GitHub, for instance. And we also have search engines that search these repositories and index the project in there and index the code in there. So, for instance, the OpenHub search engine. And the nice thing is I could query this engine for people code in that case, and then it returned a few thousand results of process models that I could download for analysis. I did some automatic validity checks on them, so to see if the software I got actually is syntactically correct, of course, and if it satisfies the basic requirements for executable process models. So if it's remarked as executable, if it contains at least one messaging activity that creates a new process instance, that are the minimum requirements. And that reduced myself then again by a few thousand process models, but in the end, I ended up with a number of models that I could live with. And to this models, I then pointed my measurement to my implementation of the metrics and obtained an equal amount of metric values. So I had a large data set, and on this data set, I could perform a few statistical tests to see if one of my metrics do provide some value. And here, just an outline of what I had a look at. For instance, there's an IEEE standard regarding software metrics that says what kind of properties metrics should fulfill, and one of the aspects is repeatability. So the standard says, if you do an experiment again, in a very similar fashion, you should receive very similar values, one significantly different values for the software. So what I did was to compute my metrics multiple times for the same test set, but with a changed test data as input, with changed performance data, because I also worked on the performance data at the same time. So I had a more precise picture of what is actually portable, added new engines and so on, and had an improved mechanism of computation. And then I just compared if the data with the updated mechanism of computation is significantly different from data I had looked at previously. And it wasn't. So I can say that at least for this data, I could show that the metrics were repeatable in the sense of that IEEE standard. Another thing I had a look at was discriminative power of metrics. So software metrics should assign different values to different pieces of software. If metric always says good to any piece of software you show it, then there's no value in computing. So you wanted to assign different values as often as possible. And what I had a look at was the amount of unique metric values in my complete test set, and the higher, the better. And here, for instance, I can show that the weight metric, the weight consideration of portability I described before, was way better than the binary mechanism that is kind of a baseline in this area. Okay, I had a look at a few more aspects, but I'd rather conclude now. So the measurement part, the measurement, how you can really quantify portability for process models, together with the evidence part, the demonstration that standards are not actually sufficient to guarantee portability as of today. That is kind of the major, the two major contributions of my PhD thesis. Yeah, and with that, I would like to conclude and give some questions.
Before we start with question and answers, I would like to point out that Vasiliki, Christoph's wife is here. Thank you for coming. Yeah, thank you. So, questions?
Yeah.
Speak up loud.
Thank you for the talk, very nice talk. I have a small, simple doubt. So when we are talking about portability, let's say for BPMN, yep, we have a core set of the symbols, and then we have extended sets.
Yep.
So did you take into account that, let's say, from engine 1 to engine 2, if the core set is portable, and or the entire set is portable, what's the difference? Did we use that extra?
I kind of looked only at the core set, because the core set is what the standard also says an engine should actually support, because the standard is precise about what an engine should support. So it's just about process models. It's not about choreographies or collaborations or the like, because these are not executable on an engine. So I only had to look about it.
Please, first.
Thank you. In your definition for portability, you said that the effort of porting will be never higher than the effort of rewriting.
That is,
but whenever you have to replace one line with multiple lines, that will happen, isn't it?
Yes, that's just, well, I can refer to the ISO standard, because that's the way the ISO standard defines it. This is the general assumption that we have. But, if it's practically really the case, is another issue, of course. I mean, what happens? if that is not valid, then of course the metric computation does not work out in the 0-1 setting. But at least from what I built, based on lines of code and just counting lines of code, I can guarantee that, because lines of code, lines with issues in them, will never be higher than the actual lines of code. Yeah, I won't find miracle lines that didn't exist in the compute program that had issues in them. But for the general computation mechanism, of course, that is an issue.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate the interdisciplinary nature of your research. And software technology, software engineering, and middleware. It's rare to find. My question to you is, you made a rather bold statement that standardization has failed. I agree, by the way. We looked at some of the numbers. So my question would be, what can the research community do that we have better chances of succeeding with the next generation of standards?
Well, very good question. That's also something I wonder about a lot. So the thing is about why do you see that? Why do engines not implement the standard as the standard defines? There are different explanations for that. Maybe part of the standards we find are just not important. Because I've also looked not another part of my PhD thesis, but I've looked at the development, how PPMN engine members implement the standard over a 5-year period, basically since, or 4-year period since the publication of PPMN 2011. And what you see is that there have been practically no new features implemented since the standard has been published. So the vendors came up with the initial set when the standard was published, and they're happy with it. So maybe we should care a little bit more about what users actually need, because it seems that this differs from what we write into the standards. So that means more empirical work on process, on how process model I use. Depends what features are actually used. I mean, it's still the question if users only use a small part of the language because it's a lot more supported. Maybe they would use more if it would actually work, but maybe they don't need it. Yeah. that there's a quite influential paper by Zumilan and Becker on how much language is enough for people. I think how much language is enough? Is it called, but they looked at that and found that really just the very small part of the language is actually just the basic stuff. The good news from my side is that the basic stuff is also supported. So you would still have portability if you just rely on it. And I also had a look in these problems and these thousands of models that I gathered, and I found the same, that just a small part of language is actually used. So we still get a fair degree of portability despite the lack of standards. But we clearly need to care more about what users actually need, and that means that we need to do more and very work. And that's also something I think that the government is pushing for at the moment. Quite a lot.
I would have given a completely different answer, but I have to speak up. Next question.
Well, to connect the concerning standardization, I agree that it didn't work in certain areas. Not a deep protocols for communicators work.
Yep.
Light bulbs work. So the question is: is people alive as a language?
Yeah.
That one is very best on it.
Huh?
That one you have to answer.
It depends on who you ask.
No. So it's a question.
No, that's also the answer. I mean, of course, the people that want to push EPMs, so the people is dead. But there are still people using people in the wild. I just think 2 or 3 weeks ago, I've talked at these with consultancies in Sweden that said me that they do use people. So it is alive in a sense. It's just we don't even know how alive it is. And I mean, that in the end, I think it will vanish in favor of PPMN, because PPMN is much stronger in the hype right now, and that's just the way things are going. But it will still take some time until it is replaced. I mean, all in all, I would say, considering portability, people was much better, because the specification was much more precise, and the formats were much more precise. I didn't fully test the executable part of PPMN because that's not possible, because the standard is not clear on how the code should actually look like. And it's not a problem with people. So we're doing a step back, in a sense, and going from people to PPMN. But that is the way the industry pushes it.
Next question. One final question.
Sort of technical question.
Yeah.
It was a bit of a striking remark for me that parallelism won't work with I mean, I'm not an expert in the area, but I was wondering.
That was, it works with people. People engines, some can do parallelism, but with people
and it wasn't working. I was wondering how much, to your experience, this is depending on the implementation of this approach. Like on the ways the compiler, for example, schedules, the processor schedules, for example, execution, or the engines.
For the 3 open source engines that I looked at, I can just say that they didn't implement it. We also asked them, and they said if we want the feature, then we can pay them some money and they will implement parallelism in the engine. But it seems that none of their customers really requires it. I cannot say, of course, based on these results, that non-BPMN engines support parallelism, because I haven't looked at all of them. But at least for the most important open source ones, I can say that in a sense. And the shadowing, they're also not good in shadowing, because we also had a look at that and they always just execute the same engineering. I mean, you could expect some randomization there, but you know, maybe a customer might require it at first. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much.